Hello everyone, Meg here from PMTVUK. I hope you are all doing well. It's very hot now, we have reached summertime. It is boiling hot in the studio and we are gonna get into a topic on this sunny afternoon that I've been dying to talk about. That's the history of Martin guitars. You may have already seen on the channel I've done before a history of acoustic guitars video, and unsurprisingly, a big part of that video was to do with Martin and how impactful they are and have been in the music industry and in the music instrument sector. Haven't yet been able to do a full Martin history video, so I'm really looking forward to getting into it. It's something that I've done a lot of reading on in the past. It's a company who have so much history and so much impact in music that I'm very much looking forward to talking about it with you all. Before I jump into the video, make sure you hit the subscribe button, click the little notification bells if you want to see any of the videos coming from me and Dagan in the future. We've got some exciting things coming up, so make sure you subscribe so you don't miss it. So let's dive into it. Martin guitars. Well, if you have seen my history of acoustic guitars video, then you should know the timeline of when this started. But Martin is one of the oldest and richest in history when it comes to acoustic guitars. So Martin and Co. Martin Guitars is a family-run business that started back in 1833. And to quote Martin themselves on their historical page on their website, Martin has six generations of family who have led this company through immeasurable changes in the world and in the world of music over its 186-year history. It's quite incredible to comprehend just how long that is and just how much this one company has had to navigate through in terms of what has changed in the world around them. But one thing we do know is that the core of their principles and their beautiful designs really haven't changed that much over time. So let's rewind and go back through history. Where did this all begin? Well, in 1776, Christian Frederick Martin was born. C.F. Martin's grandfather and great-grandfather were both violin makers, and his father was a cabinet maker who was in the Woodmakers Guild, so it was all around him. It's no surprise that he went down the path he did. As he showed a lot of interest in building guitars and instruments, and six-string guitar was still relatively new to the world at this point, they tried to get him an apprenticeship with a violin maker in Germany, but to no success, he was sent over to Vienna to train under the Viennese luthier Johan Stauffer, who was world-renowned at the time. He learned so much from him, returned back to Germany with the hopes of opening up a shop there and continuing to build his successful guitar building career. This, of course, did not go to plan, as is the world, as there was a constant dispute going on between the violin makers of the time over who had the rights to the guitar. In the references the violin makers would be using, there was no reference of the guitar yet, as it was so new. But after the passing of his father, he had enough and moved over to America. This is where the story of Martin & Co. begins. In 1833, he moves over to New York City and sets up his first shop, Lower East Side of New York. He stays there for around 5 years before moving over to the Nazareth, Pennsylvania plant. This is where Martin still remains to this day, so quite an incredible lineage of guitars and woodmakers, luthiers have been through those doors at Martin all the way back from in the early 1800s till now in the 21st century. Quite an incredible journey, and along the way, so many different evolutions and inspiring ideas have come out of Martin when it comes to the acoustic guitar market. Of course, you can imagine at the beginning, he was very much still making that Viennese style of guitar that he was taught in his apprenticeship. So the early Martin guitars very much resemble a 14th fret parlor guitar with fan bracing and ornate detailing on them. If you're lucky enough to go over to the Martin Guitar Factory, which I'm keeping my fingers crossed, I will get to visit soon. They have as many of these early guitars as they could find throughout the world on display there, where you can see a full evolutional journey of where these guitars grew to. But yes, those early guitars, very much like a parlor guitar as we would know it now, are where it started. It took a surprisingly long time for the designs that we know acoustics to have today to reach the forefront. It wasn't till 1916, for example, that Martin had mastered the design of a dreadnought acoustic, something that we all know as a flagship body shape today. I have two behind me here, and there's so many different brands and models that use this particular size, the Dreadnought. In the early days, CF Martin was building a lot with a friend of his called Henry, who'd come over from Germany as well. Henry Schatz was also inspired by the Venetian way of building guitars, so together they would have evolved this a lot. Eventually, they moved over to a more square-style headstock from the sort of curved headstock of the time, and then came an exploration into different bracings. By the 1840s, 1830s, the X bracing was seen in its earliest form. Slightly different to the X bracing we see now, it essentially had a double X bracing inside, but this is where it would have evolved. And at the time, guitar builders and luthiers weren't particularly interested in the X bracing. As you can imagine, fan bracing was the most popular choice, so anything straying away from that might have seemed like it needn't be there. So from there, in 1843, they began to experiment a little bit with body sizes. In the 1850s, we had the first O body shape, and then came the double O body shape. This is slightly bigger than a parlor, although not far off, so we're still somewhere around the general parlor style of body shape, which would have been widely used at the time. In the 1900s came the first triple O body shape, which is this one here, and another famous guitar body shape that has stayed with Martin throughout. Then came in 1916, arguably the most pivotal design from Martin guitars, the Dreadnought Acoustic. Named after the Dreadnought ships, this came and surprisingly didn't take the world by storm when it was first released in 1916. It wasn't till it was reworked and re-released in the 1920s that it was taken more by musicians and gradually began to grow into the popular body shape that we know it today. In fact, the Dreadnought has been used by so many famous artists across the decades that it's impossible to mention them all. Everyone from Joni Mitchell to Crosby, Stills and Nash, Bob Dylan, Bruce Springsteen, David Gilmour from Pink Floyd, and I could go on and on and on with all of the artists who have used this famous guitar. Even Keith Richards from the Rolling Stones has been seen playing a Martin Dreadnought on stage. This is one of the most pivotal designs and has stayed across the music instrument world ever since its very first introduction. Every brand uses a form of Dreadnought now. It is a punchy, loud and powerful design which allows for a lot of bottom end as well as a lot of clarity. And the rosewood back on sides used on most of the D28s and the higher end Dreadnought models gives this guitar so much volume and so much clarity that it is incredibly popular. But the Dreadnought really took form in 1934. That's when we saw the first 14 fret Dreadnought, the way that we see them today. It was obviously refined and reworked from the somewhat flop in 1916, and it was around this time that we started to see guitars which would now be considered the birth of the flat top acoustic as we know it today. X bracing inside, Martin's dovetail neck join, 14 fret join, and bigger bodies. Everything that we know acoustics for today. By this point too, During this big evolution of the flat top acoustic, steel strung guitars, Dreadnoughts, and the triple O body shape, the company was being led by Frank Henry Martin. CF Martin Jr. did take over the company for a short while, but Frank Henry Martin stepped in and looked after the company for over 60 years, leading it through some of its most pivotal and impactful changes. It was also under Frank Henry Martin's leadership that mandolins became a big part of Martin's design and builds. Mandolins were very popular at the time, with the emerging folk and blues scene sweeping across America, as well as the ukulele scene that came from the Hawaiian music of popularity in the 1920s. Martin stepped into all of these, and through its intricate mandolin designs, it then stepped over to some more intricate inlays on its acoustic guitars. If you've seen some of the ornate higher-end models of Martin, you will see how detailed and intricate the inlays, the sound hole rosettes, and things like this can be on the guitars. This was all inspired a lot by how detailed and beautiful their mandolins would look. And alongside bigger bodies in this time, Frank Henry Martin helped to also see the jump towards thinner necks, so more playable acoustics, hence the increased popularity amongst players of these fantastic acoustic guitars. The Chris Martin that is now in charge and has been for the most recent history of Martin has cited that the way that Frank Henry Martin attempted to build ukuleles at the time was he overbuilt them, imagining them lot to be like a guitar, when the magic formula really came for Martin when they simplified the design and scaled it back. After all, with an instrument like ukulele, it really is a lot about the woods and how they sing out and how playable they are. Details and unnecessary appointments on the ukulele don't necessarily impact them as much as tone and playability will. Throughout the 1960s, Martin continued to gain popularity as the folk scene took over the world with the likes of Bob Dylan, Joan Baez, Joni Mitchell, and Neil Young taking over the songwriting scene. All of these famous musicians continued to use Martins at their live shows, and this magic formula they created for the Dreadnought Acoustic remained virtually the same, with the few odd additions as they went up the series of different tone woods. But they'd mastered it, and there wasn't really any need to keep changing this design when you already have it down to a fine art. The 60s really were a fantastic time for acoustic guitar musicians, and as it started to lend towards more rock and psychedelic music at the end of the 60s and the early 70s, Martin guitars were still a key part of this. If you've seen any live Led Zeppelin performances or Pink Floyd performances, for example, from the 1970s, then you will have seen them using their Martin guitars on stage. The real trouble came, I think, when it started to head towards the 80s, where electric guitars really were more prominent. A strange time for a lot of music instrument companies as a whole, as things really shifted more to electronic products. And after a brief window of trying out electric guitars in the 1960s with the GT70, Martin didn't see their hand much with this and decided to focus most on what they do best, acoustic guitars. Although if you are a guitar nut, you might know about the window of time in 1985 where the Singer range of guitars, Korean-built S-type electric guitars were produced by Martin, but there wasn't much footprint of Martin in the company. Hard to tie it up with the Martin that we know and love. And there's not a lot of information about these electrics out there, so perhaps a time period in Martin they'd rather not delve into too much, as acoustic guitars really are where all of their historical prevalence has lied. Despite this, Martin stuck to its guns and continued to do what it does best and build really beautiful acoustic guitars. The 90s was a really good time for growth and innovation for the Martin brand, and this is when we saw the introduction of high-pressure laminate style guitars and the opening of a second factory over in Mexico where they could push up the output but keep down the cost for people who wanted more accessible but well-playing Martin guitars. Seeing their first laminate back and sides guitar, the D1, in 1993, and then this led to the range of DX Martins, which had at the forefront a desire to make them more sustainably produced, more accessible for all, and more affordable guitars, but still with that Martin shine to them. And if you've ever seen the MTV Unplugged 2, you will know that famous time from the 90s where Kurt Cobain used his Martin guitar for his MTV Unplugged performance. A performance that many of us know and love, and that guitar is such a key part of it. So the 90s as a whole were a reasonably good time for guitar builders and a great time in Martin's history. And it was also in 1990 that the company hit their 500,000th guitar milestone, an incredible feat, and just 14 years after that they hit their 1 millionth guitar in 2004. With this, they created a beautiful commemoration guitar worth £1 million with the most incredible and beautiful ornate details. The latest innovation of Martin guitars came with the Martin SC13E, the one just behind me here. A really unique and interesting build of guitar that plays a lot like an electric guitar, with that thin body, that scoop shaped body shape, and the really, really playable neck, as well as the no heavy gloss finish, giving it a really natural and earthy sound. These guitars have been really fun to play, and for Martin, just a slightly different and more unique design. Very scaled back on the aesthetics with the black scratch plate and those simple dot inlays. It's all about the raw earthiness of this guitar, and it's been incredibly popular across the music stores. But the main thing with this body shape is it's something that Martin haven't really done before. That thin electric style body and sound, which is very desirable, particularly for players who play a lot of lead guitar and are looking for something really, really comfortable to play on stage that isn't as big or as bassy as a Dreadnought or a Grand Auditorium or Triple O style body shape. So you can't be denied that Martin Guitar is a company that is just absolutely abundant with incredible history. Across its six generations of family who have worked in the company, Chris Martin, the current CEO, has helped see Martin into the 21st century through all of the technological changes that are happening in the world. And it still remains one of the most prominent acoustic guitar brands in the entire acoustic guitar world. The likes of Ed Sheeran brought the LX1 series to life with his use of it on tour. We've seen these grow in popularity as people jump to get a travel size acoustic for going out on the road or for playing shows with. The way Ed used it with his loop pedal live on stage has inspired so many creators to do the same. The Dreadnought still remains a flagship acoustic, and as well as the Triple O body shape, with lots of other brands taking their inspiration for body shapes and designs from Martin and the legacy it has left. If you never had the joy of playing a Martin, whether an old vintage one or a new one, I couldn't recommend it more. And if anyone sees a vintage 1960s D28 that they think needs a new home and they want to kindly gift it to me, I am always open for that. That's the one guitar that I absolutely dream of getting my hands on. I hope you've enjoyed this dive into Martin and the history of this incredible company, how much of an impact it's had on acoustic guitar building, and how many people have been inspired by this incredible, incredible journey. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you have enjoyed this video. If you have, make sure to give it a like and subscribe to the channel. You can also find us over on socials at Play Music Today. You can find us on TikTok too if you want to watch some TikToks. I've been Meg, and I will see you all in another acoustic guitar video very soon.